So perhaps that's something to look forward to. Now, I don't know if anybody here remembers Lord of the Rings.
Yes.
And has seen the films. But you may remember there's three films which I've read all about the ring being destroyed, but almost nothing at all on what happens after the ring is destroyed. So I thought it was quite a good idea, at least Steve Crowder told me it was a good idea, that we should take a look at the UK after Brexit and to shed some light onto the so-called leap in the dark. So let's go and dwell momentarily in the sunlit uplands after Brexit. Well, first of all, we will have got our democracy back. The only people making our laws will be people we have actually voted for. Our laws and regulations will come from Parliament, from the youth, and not from unelected bureaucrats in Brussels. We will regain our full voice at the World Trade Organization and a whole host of other international organizations where our voice has been muted, rendered almost dumb of one of 28 in the EU. We will sign trade agreements in our own national interest, and we will have got back repatriated our powers to negotiate these trade agreements. We will have re-established the supremacy of our own law. We will have got back our own waters, which accounts for more than two-thirds of what the EU calls its waters, and our fishermen will be allowed to fish. Our commerce will no longer suffer unnecessary interference and job-destroying regulation. No longer will waves of unskilled immigrants from Eastern Europe drive down the wages so British people cannot get properly paid work. Immigration will be via an Australian-style point system, and that we cannot do at the moment. More especially, no longer will we have a Prime Minister who stands by, side by side, when the French President makes threats against the United Kingdom. Yeah. This was a disgrace, and indeed it's likely that the Prime Minister egged on Monsieur Hollande to do just that. Mr. Hollande is diminutive anyway, but he diminishes France and diminishes himself when he threatens the UK in this way. On regional aid, which for instance is important to Cornwall, we can pay where we like, for what we like, and to who we like, with no EU strings attached. And in particular, there will be no more EU subsidies to the BBC. Yeah. Now, let's take a look at what we're paying out to be threatened. These are our membership fees. This comes from Professor Tim Collins and Gerald Batlin in his great work, and there's about 100 pages backing it up. Now, just the direct costs of the EU are well known at over £50 million a day. But there's also the indirect costs of EU regulation. And one example of that just now, here, is the Port of Bristol, where 8,000 jobs are threatened by a forthcoming EU directive. Hopefully it will be stopped in time, but we can't count on it. Let me make the essential point that less, significantly less, than 15% of our economy is accounted for by trade with people and businesses with the member states of the old European Union. Nevertheless, 100% of our economy is subject to EU regulation, which moreover our civil service rigorously enforces. Outside the EU, the UK will be financially stronger and better off. Now, one of the reasons given for being in the EU is our so-called influence. So let's take for a couple of moments I don't think anything's going to happen at all. Well, how much influence do we actually have? In the Council of Ministers, until November, the UK had just 8.24% of the votes. And that number decreased each time there was a new member state. In a few short years, Bosnia, Serbia, Moldova, Albania, and Macedonia, all very poor countries, will be in the EU. So in consequence, our so-called influence in the EU will be even less. And as others have said, let's not forget that the Liberal Democrats, Greens, Labour, and especially the Conservatives, all want Turkey to become a member state of the European Union with its fast rate population of 75 million. Now, MEPs are not particularly important, but for the record, the UK has just 9.7% of MEPs. And in case anybody's interested, it's 73 out of 751. But more important is the Commission, which I'm going to look at for about the next couple of minutes. In the Commission, which is, as it were, the government, the UK has 1 out of 28 commissioners. And by the way, Mrs. Thatcher's day, we had 2 of 13. Rather different. Now let's have a look and see where the UK commissioner sits in what's intended to be the European government. So first of all, here's the president of the commission, a former prime minister of Luxembourg, a very grand fromage indeed. But by the way, Luxembourg's population is less than half that of Gloucestershire. So there's the president with his private jet, which by the way is a Cessna citation for the curious. I looked it up. And below him are the two first vice presidents, who I hope are going to appear. There they are, who report directly to the president of the commission. I'm just wondering, are either of these a British commissioner? I can hear you asking. And the answer is, I'm afraid not. So let's go to the reporting tier below. Surely there are four of these. Surely one of these must be the British commissioner. I'm afraid not. Now here is the final tier. With 20 commissioners. And here at last we see fourth spear carrier from the bottom. Somewhere between the Slovenian and the Slovakian commissioner is our very own UK commissioner, outlined in blue. I think it should be red, actually, but anyway, it's blue. And he directly reports, in case you're curious, to the commissioner from Finland, who's younger than he is. So the fact is very clear. We're giving up being an independent country in order to have one insignificant commissioner in the fourth tier of the commission, on the fourth level, as it were, in the back of the plane. I haven't read this anywhere else, so I think this you can count as being original research, but it's actually readily available. Now, to go back to the point about influence, since they started keeping the records in 1996, there have been 72 proposals from the European Union Commission, which the UK government opposed and wanted to block because they perceived it as being the UK's national interest. And this even includes the government of Tony Blair. Now, I'm sure everybody here is also wondering just how many of these 72 proposals from since 1996 the UK government actually succeeded in blocking. Was it all of them? No. Was it 50 of the 72?
No.
Was it perhaps half?
No.
Was it 25?
No.
Surely it must be at least 10.
No.
I'm afraid not.
No.
The answer is none. Niente. Zero. Zilch. Nil. The fact is that the UK has no meaningful or worthwhile influence in the European Union, and the mantra, the chant of influence, influence, influence that we hear all the time from Europhile politicians and their hangers-on in the media has absolutely no basis in reality at all. We have no worthwhile influence, and we never will have. Now to trade. Some people suggest or imply, bizarrely, that on Brexit, all our trade with the EU would cease. Will cease, I should say. And you would certainly have this impression if you listen to Mr. Cameron or Newsnight on BBC Two. So let's look at some real facts. This is new, I only came up with this about 3 weeks ago. China exports more goods to the EU than does the UK. Oh, it's disappeared. I'll just repeat it again. You read this carefully, it is worth seeing. It's billions of euros. China exports more goods to the EU than the UK. And has done since the record's been kept, certainly the last 5 years. It's clear that China has access to the EU markets. And China, Mr. Cameron, is not a member of the EU. Not yet, anyway. Switzerland has an economy that's one quarter the size of ours, and Switzerland is not a member of the EU. Nevertheless, Switzerland exports to the EU more per person than the UK. It's over 4.5 times more and has been consistently so for the last 7 or 8 years. And this you will not hear from the Prime Minister. What he does tell us is that any future UK-EU trade agreement would have to have a free movement of people clause. Now the Prime Minister has been trotting this out all over the country, but it's simply not true. The facts are as follows. And this is not project fear, this is project fact. The EU has, according to how you count them, over 100 trade agreements. Out of all these trade agreements, only 4 of them, the EFTA agreements, have a free movement of people clause. Even within the continent of Europe, the EU has trade agreements with 10 countries without a free movement of people clause. Without a free movement of people clause. To give just 4 of them, those without, we don't hear from David Cameron. And David Cameron is simply deceiving the electorate on this one, and as Prime Minister, he should be ashamed of himself. He'd have been not. Now, I hardly ever agree with the former leader of the Scottish Nationalist Party, Alex Salmond, but it's clearly the case that on Brexit, David Cameron should resign. He has proved himself. It is proven that he is entirely feeble in negotiating with the European Union, and he has shown himself wholly unable to defend the or advance or progress the interests of this country. What we do hear from Mr. Cameron is the so-called 3 million jobs disappearing on Brexit. This is tendentious nonsense, total tosh. At least 4 million jobs in the EU, and it's probably more like 5 million, depend on trade with the UK. We can be absolutely certain that trade will continue, and that the only people who will lose their jobs on Brexit are members of the European Parliament, such as myself. And now to finish. A former president of Israel once said, people age, dreams are ageless. And we on our side of the argument have always had a dream. And our dream after Brexit is of an independent country that is not a promise in a protectionist European superstate. Yeah. That can rule itself. Rules and laws prevail, that is international and outward-looking, that has a full seat on the World Trade Organization, that can make its own choices, that controls its own borders, that has an ethical policy on immigration, that is self-confident. That is our dream. And this dream can come true only on Brexit, where, if I may quote myself, we are out of the EU and into the world. Yeah. However, the last word should not be mine. The last word should go to Winston Churchill, who once wrote, and this will be familiar to many people here, If Britain must choose between Europe and the open sea, she must always choose the open sea.
Yeah.